And there's something different about Duke. It just fosters a closeness, I think, between people. All of the guys have a sense of the history of the program. This whole thing has been building and growing.
5 seconds will tick off. The entire crowd standing here at Cameron Indoor Stadium for the 700th victory for Coach Mike Krzyzewski.
I felt personally responsible to try to get us over the hump.
2001 turns out to be a Blue Devil
Odyssey. The way he was playing, that if he caught the ball, then he'd find a way to win.
Shoot!
You're not going to believe who they just hired. Can't tell you because I can't pronounce his name, but it's the guy at Army.
We had this innocence about us, and I just don't know if we were ready to win.
That was a brawl.
We could have been the national champs that year. That killed us.
The story of Duke basketball, I think, is the story of a group of people who enjoy an athletic activity and how it can be intertwined in the outreach of a great academic institution, how things can be done with dignity and be done at a very high level and sustained.
In September of 1892, Trinity College's 113 students and two professors packed up its books and belongings and left the rural setting of Randolph County, North Carolina, which had been its home for 50 years. It was moving to a place with telegraphs, railroads, and all the amenities of modern living. It was moving to Durham. Trinity's president, John F. Crowell, a Northerner, wanted to, in his words, provide people with modern learning at the service of the people under the guidance of the Christian truth.
Its roots go back to 1838. It took the name Trinity, I think, in 1859. They did something very daring. They brought a young Yale-trained Yankee president down, and he said if Trinity is ever going to really do anything, it's going to have to move to town, because it was 50 miles to the west of us in a very isolated rural setting. Durham was becoming a hub for tobacco manufacturing by that time. The South needed a first-rate research university.
The move was financed by tobacco mogul Washington Duke, who lived in Durham. Duke pledged $85,000 of his own money to help finance the move.
Washington Duke, he's an old-fashioned educator. He's in the old-fashioned 19th century style, really. He thought a healthy body was just as important as a trained mind. He believed in athletics.
In keeping with this philosophy, Trinity established its physical education department. Alumnus Wilbur Wade Card, known simply as Cap, was named head of the new program.
I think this is a guy who was a 19th century jock. He was very obviously somebody that was enormously interested in the physical components of a human being.
He kept copious notes of every freshman student, size of height, weight. So he believed very strongly in physical education as well as the mental aspect.
In 1905, Card was approached by Richard Crozier, the basketball coach at Wake Forest. Crozier proposed a game between the two schools. Invented in 1891 by James Naismith, basketball was a relatively unknown sport in the South. Card became familiar with the game while studying physical education at Harvard in 1900. The game looked very different than today.
They literally did have peach baskets. So the ball went into the goal, it didn't go through. And you had a broom, it had a hole in the bottom of the peach basket, so you put the broom handle up through the bottom of the basket to punch the ball out after the shot had been made.
The game had center jump to start each quarter, center jump after free throws, center jump after two-point shots, a designated free throw shooter. It simply wasn't anything close to the run-up and down exciting game that we know today.
Card quickly converted the Angia B. Duke Gymnasium so Trinity could properly host the game. Better known as the Ark because of its narrow walkway that allowed only two people to enter at a time, the gym was so small a person could easily shoot from one basket into another. Then, as strange as it seems, Card had to teach the game of basketball to Durham. The game in question is called basketball, one of the most fascinating and intensely interesting indoor games known today. Many preparations have been made with the view of starting practices as soon as the examinations are over.
I didn't get around to playing the game until March the 2nd of 1906. It's appropriate, perhaps, that March Madness today started in March 1906.
Even though it was not the first intercollegiate game in the state, it was the first between two Tobacco Road teams. Wake Forest prevailed and beat Card's team 24-10.
The team started from there and played schools which were not much more than high schools, YMCAs.
Although he remained at the school working in athletics, Card stepped down as head basketball coach in 1912. In the following years, the sport's popularity grew, and by the early 20s, the team had outgrown the confines of the Ark and moved to the brand new and much larger Alumni Memorial Gym. Basketball, it seemed, was here to stay. In December of 1924, Washington Duke's son, tobacco mogul James B. Duke, established the Duke Endowment, which funded several Carolina schools, including Trinity. The trustees promptly renamed the school Duke University to honor its patron family. With money in hand, Duke, the university, quickly expanded to what would later be known as West Campus. By 1926, the school looked more like a construction site than an elite academic center. Almost as significant was the arrival in 1926 of a new freshman football coach named Eddie Cameron. 2 years later, he added head basketball coach to his list of duties.
First time I met Eddie Cameron was in these basketball tryouts, and I liked him right away. Young fella, enthusiastic, intelligent, interested in you personally. Eddie was a good coach.
Bill Werber, who would later play professional baseball with the New York Yankees and Boston Red Sox, was Duke's first big recruit. But if initial impressions had counted for anything, Werber and his teammate Harry Counselor may have never played for Duke.
We had envisioned ivy-covered walls and a beautiful green grass. When we got out to the Duke campus, it was a shock because there was a train running up the middle of the campus. They were completing the auditorium at the end of the campus. The center of the campus was a great big sea of mud when it rained, and the dust of the workmen around finishing work on the dormitories and the auditorium. It was a miserable place.
Werber and Counselor quickly recovered from the university's shocking state and focused on basketball. In the fall of 1927, the two were sophomores and proudly wearing the Duke uniform. But Werber knew that something was missing from the team.
Bill Werber was Duke's first recruiter. He realized their team didn't have a center.
He went to the athletic director, Jimmy DeHart, and we said, Coach, we're lacking a good center. If we get a good center down here, we'd have a good basketball team. We need a big man. Now, back at Tech High School, we had a guy that was a pretty good center, Joe Croson.
The next thing you know, Joe is playing basketball at Duke, and he's their starting center and was certainly good enough. He became second-team All-Conference.
Werber and Counselor quickly began training their friend for the upcoming game with local rival, the University of North Carolina, and their large, imposing center named Tiny Harper.
We'd stand Joe Croson up to the brick wall, and then we'd dribble around, Harry and myself, and then all of a sudden we'd fire that ball, and Joe would duck. And then the game with Carolina, Joe would duck and we'd fire, and it hit Tiny Harper under the chin and knocked him all the way back into the crowd. We didn't have any more trouble with Tiny Harper. I wouldn't recommend that, though.
They were the most successful team Duke had ever had. at that point, and they won a lot of games, scored a lot of points for those days, and played, I guess, more of an up-tempo game than people were used to.
Werber, who Cameron would later call the best player he ever had, led Duke to two Southern Conference finals before graduating as the school's first basketball All-American. Meanwhile, Cameron was looking for ways to improve his team. He attended a coaching clinic led by an Indiana high school coach named Everett Case. Case was teaching a new tactic called the fast break. Cameron quickly introduced the strategy to his players, who embraced this faster pace of play. Cameron's 1938 team, known as the Never a Dull Moment Boys, were not the most talented group of players, but they did what no other Duke team had done. They won the Southern Conference Tournament, the first trophy in Duke's storied program.
They were a bunch of clowns. They won the Southern Conference Tournament. They had no business winning it. They just had fun playing. They didn't have a very successful season, regular season. When they got to the tournament, they just exploded and had a real good time.
As early as 1935, Cameron and athletic director Wallace Wade were working on ideas for an arena that would be exclusively for basketball, going so far as to sketch plans for one on a matchbook.
One of Eddie Cameron's strengths and one of the things he was most proud of is looking ahead and planning ahead. He had been brought in to fill up a new 35,000-seat football stadium. He is the one who undoubtedly made the decision to build the large basketball arena.
But with the country mired in the Depression, even the Duke family pockets were not deep enough to get Cameron his arena. He would have to find the money somewhere else.
Football was the big sport. Baseball was probably second. Basketball was just coming into prominence in the 30s.
Duke is driving deep into Trojan territory. The ball goes to Robinson, and he makes 5 yards.
The football team went undefeated, untied, and unscored on a play in the Rose Bowl and lost in the last few seconds. They took the money from the Rose Bowl to be able to build a basketball arena, $400,000. Which would have been a phenomenal amount to spend on any athletic building.
Cameron knew his matchbook sketch would not suffice, so the school turned to Horace Trumbau, whose firm had designed West Campus. Trumbau assigned the job to Julian Abel, the mastermind behind West Campus's Gothic design. The talented Abel was one of the first black architects in the country, but racial attitudes denied him from being on site to supervise the construction. In fact, it wasn't until years after his death in 1950 that he ever received public credit for his work.
Not only was it the only building of its kind in the South, but the fact that some school had gone to the trouble of building an arena exclusively for the basketball team. And it was years beyond that before most people built significant other arenas.
Duke Indoor Stadium opened its doors on January 6, 1940. It was the third largest arena in the country behind Philadelphia's Palestra, another Trumbau creation, and Madison Square Garden. But the momentous occasion almost ended before it began.
This was a page one story, and so they got a lot of attention for this building. There were a lot of dignitaries there.
They were all up there on the platform, and every light in the building went out. Some sort of electrical malfunction. People started lighting cigarettes. You could see a bunch of fireflies flying around.
Once the lights were restored, Duke dispatched Princeton 36-27 to christen the court. Cameron led the team to a 19-7 record and reached the conference finals. A year later, 1941, Cameron earned his second Southern Conference title, and when his 1942 team repeated as conference champions, there was no doubt about it. Duke hoops were on the map for good.
42 team was probably one of Eddie's best, Cameron's best, because they had four players off the
Durham High School team that went 3 years with a great unbeaten record. The Loftus boys and Bob Gant and Gordon Carver, four of the five starters on that team, came to Duke as a group.
It was Cameron's third conference championship in seven appearances. It would also be his last. With his arena built and the basketball program clearly established as a power, Cameron stepped in as coach after the 1942 season. His record of 226 wins against just 99 defeats stood as the standard at Duke for more than 50 years. Jerry Girard moved over one seat on the Duke bench to replace Cameron as head coach in 1943, and the team didn't miss a beat.
Jerry was very vibrant, was very interested in his team, was more of an emotional coach.
During his tenure, Girard would coach two of Duke's most prodigious talents, navigate his team through the uncertainty of war, and secretly fight a personal battle he could not win. By 1943, World War II had already altered the Duke campus, turning it into a quasi-naval base for officers in training.
The V-12 program was instituted by the federal government, kind of an ROTC program, we would call it today, but it highly accelerated. The university went to a quarter system to accommodate it. You took concentrated courses quickly, you graduated early, you went into service.
While lack of manpower caused many universities to abandon the sport, the V-12 program ensured that Duke would have enough students to keep its basketball program up and running.
That's when they played literally with nobody there because there were blackouts or the students were not permitted to come to the games. Duke played basketball during that entire period.
Girard's squad played predominantly military teams, which were filled with ex-pros and college players. In 1944, the Blue Devils were 13-13, losing to non-conference military powerhouses like Carolina Preflight, Norfolk NAS, and Fort Bragg. But Girard's men rebounded from their mediocre regular season and steamrolled through the conference tournament, earning their coach his first Southern Conference title. The V-12 program also provided Duke with one of the most unusual transfers in college basketball history. In the fall of 1944, future two-time All-American Ed Coffenberger was transferred to Duke from the University of North Carolina.
The Navy sent me to the University of North Carolina in March of 44. I was there for 8 months, which was the equivalent of two semesters now. And then I asked for engineering and NROTC. Much to my surprise, I got transferred from Carolina to Duke.
While Coffenberger's unusual move to Duke did not create the rivalry between these neighbor schools, it did set the wheels in motion for what would be one of sport's most enduring rivalries. In 1946, Coffenberger led the undermanned Blue Devils against the nationally ranked Tar Heels as they fought for dominance of the Southern Conference.
I remember some of the newspaper clippings identify we were a little team even back then with a few just over six footers, and that was as tall as we got. We played North Carolina over at UNC that year and beat them in an overtime. I happened to score the 2 points right at the very end of the game that tied the game, and I think we beat them 51-46. That was certainly a highlight game for us, beating them on their floor. There clearly was a Duke-UNC rivalry.
Duke went on to its seventh straight conference final, where they trounced Wake and captured their fifth Southern Conference title. The fall of 1948 marked the arrival of a freshman from Pennsylvania named Dick Groat. Talented in both baseball and basketball, Groat did not wait for Duke to recruit him.
I read an article when I was a senior in high school in Sport Magazine, and it was a story about Coach Jack Coombs, who had a great reputation as a college baseball coach. And at that time, I thought I wanted to play Major League Baseball. So I ended up asking a friend by the name of John Michael Olson, who was coaching the Pittsburgh Steelers, to call down at Duke.
Michael Olson was informed by a friend at Duke that the university did not give baseball scholarships.
John supposedly said, well, he's a basketball player, too. He said, well, how good is he? He said, his brother says he's pretty good. And I've often laughed because I'm sure Coach K and Dean Smith haven't recruited a kid because his brother said he could play.
Down in Durham, North Carolina, they're shouting the praises of this good thing that comes in a small package. By present-day standards, Grote is a little guy.
Dick Grote was a phenomenal athlete.
A great shooter. He drove for the basket in a variety of different ways. He had little hook shots in and around the basket. He could penetrate like nobody we've ever seen.
He knew how to play, and he was the most competitive person that I've ever known.
Some people said, you know, he couldn't jump, he couldn't run, he couldn't steal second base. He just beat you.
After an outstanding season on the freshman team, Grote looked forward to his sophomore year when he could finally play varsity ball. But unbeknownst to the players, their coach was very ill.
I presume he knew that it was a terminal situation. Jerry was a stoic, and I'm sure that he and Eddie Cameron wanted to keep it as private as they possibly could. There was never an announcement that, you know, Jerry Girard has got cancer.
Cameron wanted a coach in place in case Girard's health deteriorated. So in September of 1949, with Girard's blessing, he quietly began to look for a replacement for his ailing coach. He enticed pro basketball coach Red Auerbach to take a job as a consultant to the team. Auerbach did not attend practice, but he did work with the players one-on-one.
Practice was at 3. I had to be there at 1. And Red taught me defense, taught me moves, made me believe in myself. He taught me more in 2.5 months than all the rest of my coaches put together.
Then, just before New Year's, Auerbach left Duke.
I was heartbroken when he called me aside and said, young man, you're the first one. I want you to know Jerry Girard is the finest man I've ever known in my life, and I cannot sit here and wait for this man to pass away. He said, he's a wonderful man. He said, but I'm going back to pro basketball.
Sadly, just as the 1951 season was underway, Girard's cancer had worsened. After 8 years at the helm and a 131-78 record, he stepped down as head coach. He passed away 2 months later at the age of 47. With the urgent task of replacing his head coach, Eddie Cameron turned to Hartwick College coach Harold Bradley. His success at turning around Hartwick's losing program convinced Cameron that Bradley was just what Duke needed. Critics worried that Bradley was ill-prepared to compete with the growing competition of local Tobacco Road rival State, Carolina, and Wake Forest. While Bradley's first 2 years as coach was nothing spectacular, Grote was nothing but.
And with Dick Grote tallying 20 points and handing off 9 assists for a new Hall record.
As a junior in 1951, Grote scored an astonishing 831 points during the season. Not only did that double it Coffenberger's Duke mark, but it also set a new national record. But scoring wasn't his only talent. He was also among the team's leaders in assists.
There's Grote dribbling straight up the middle. He loses the ball momentarily, but even while on his back, manages to pass to a teammate.
It seemed he did everything on the court except sweep up after the games, and he probably did some of that too.
I had a deal with the maintenance man. I'd go in to shower and get dressed, take the basketball, and it kept it in my locker. So I left the window open, and I could get into Cameron Indoor Stadium. He taught me how to turn the lights on. So we had an awful lot of 11, 12 o'clock night basketball games. Many times after we played a game that night, we'd come back down at midnight and play some more.
It was competitive, and you know, but it was fun also. But we wanted to win. Whoever's team you were on wanted to win. It was just like playground ball, really.
We would assign one guy, when the police come, you go up and cut the lights off so we can get out of here and don't know who it is.
If you've ever seen Cameron, I mean, one light you would know it was on. So people had to know what was going on. Somebody undoubtedly had investigated to determine who's in there, if it had been you and me coming in off the street, I think we'd have been kicked out in 2 minutes. But they knew it was Grote, and nobody ever said a word.
Grote played his final home game on February 29, 1952, against Carolina.
He already held the school scoring record of 47, but the conference scoring record he didn't hold.
I threw passes to him that I would, I probably had layups, but I wanted for him to score, and we just kept feeding him and feeding him and feeding him. Yeah, it was crazy. He did a nice job.
You don't score 48 points every night, and certainly against an arch rival, it's something very, very special. When they took me out that night with maybe a half a minute or something, a minute to go, I don't know how much time, when the Carolina players came over and shook hands with me and hugged me, it was one of the greatest experiences I've ever had in sports.
Grote was a basketball player at heart, and in fact, his last statement to me was, I consider myself a retired basketball player, although he played 14 years of professional baseball.
Dick Grote ended his career as a two-time All-American, 1952's National Player of the Year, and had a career average of 23 points per game, which remains second on the all-time list at Duke. With Grote gone and no starting seniors, the 1953 Blue Devils were a lackluster 4-5. There was no denying Bradley's team was talented, but he found it increasingly difficult to compete with his neighbors down the road. For two decades under Eddie Cameron and then Jerry Girard, Duke held sway in the Southern Conference, but the power had shifted. Innovators and master recruiters Everett Case at NC State and Frank McGuire at Carolina were now leading the way. In 1954, the North Carolina basketball scene changed forever when Eddie Cameron spearheaded the formation of one of the most influential leagues in the country, the Atlantic Coast Conference. Decades later, Duke would dominate the conference with an unprecedented number of trophies.
The Southern Conference was too big and too unwieldy. They wanted a conference where they could play everybody in football every year and everybody in basketball every year.
The Southern Conference had maybe 25 members, was widely scattered. The ACC was more compact with like-minded schools.
They wanted a smaller, more representative league, and it was built around the four North Carolina schools.
Led by sophomores Ronnie Mayer and Joe Belmont, Duke finished fourth in the season in scoring, and the Blue Devils won the ACC's inaugural regular season in 1954. In the following year, they faced off against Case's Wolfpack in the conference tournament final. With the tournament being held at Reynolds Coliseum, State rode the home court advantage to an 87-77 win over the Blue Devils. Despite losing in the ACC final, Duke was awarded its first NCAA tournament appearance when ACC title winner State was suspended from the national tournament for recruiting violations. The Blue Devils' first round loss to Villanova muted the excitement surrounding the school's first appearance in a national championship tournament. After the formation of the ACC, Bradley's teams remained competitive, finishing as high as first in 1958. But the face of college basketball was evolving, and Duke was looking towards the future.
When McGuire arrived at Carolina, all of a sudden we had five New Yorkers playing in Chapel Hill, and they won the 1957 national championship. So that was a very different type of recruiting world that the Harold Bradleys weren't really ready for. So I think when Harold Bradley left for Texas, he picked the right time to leave with what was going on in the conference at that time.
Bradley's record at Duke was excellent. In his 9 years, he led the Blue Devils to 167 wins, suffered only 78 losses, and never coached a losing season. In the spring of 1959, after a lengthy national search, Vic Bubas, an assistant to Everett Case at NC State, was hired to replace Bradley. Duke's willingness to hire a rival team's coach signaled how badly they wanted to win the ACC championship.
There was a certain element within the Duke community that was not happy about that, because NC State did not necessarily represent the type of educational institution that some at Duke thought their coach should come from. And NC State was sort of the bad guy because they won so many games and dominated. Eddie Cameron obviously had the fortitude and the ability with the president to hire their number one assistant.
I had been the head assistant coach. I was fortunate enough to get the job, and that was one of the coaching plums, if you want to call it, in the country at that time.
Vic comes, and instead of doing the political thing and hiring a nice name, a recent player from Duke as a freshman coach, he hires me, another state guy. And so, you know, that just shows the kind of decision-making. He didn't do the easy thing. He looked long-term, and vision is the one thing that Everett Case had that I think Vic Bubas just, he exuded it. I mean, he was always two steps ahead of everybody.
Bubas' attention to detail was immense, from coaching to ticket sales. There wasn't an aspect of the program which he did not personally oversee. It was a new approach for college basketball, and one that would be emulated for decades to come.
He brought management of recruiting. He was a perfectionist. He was a delegator. One coach would be given the defensive assignments. One coach would be given the offensive assignments.
He was a master recruiter, he was a master organizer, and a great basketball coach.
We do the usual coaching stuff, good guy, bad guy. So-and-so's not getting on the boards today. And Vic would say, you get all over him, you know. And so I'd get all over him today. And after practice, Vic would say, now, come on, you got to hang in there now, you know.
You could tell that he was very organized. Practices were timed down to the minute. And he also was interesting, he put towels over the clocks, because he didn't want players looking at the clocks to see how much time you had to go.
He got the respect that was needed for a head coach from the players. He had the ability to get players to put aside their egos and play together.
Coach Bubas very seldom raised his voice. I always said Vic treated players as gentlemen. He expected you to act like young men. He put responsibility on your shoulders and expected you to live up to it.
Bubas inherited a solid team from Bradley and had high hopes for his 1960 team.
I made some bold statement to the news media. I never did that before. One of them, I said, I think we're going to win the whole thing. And he looked at me like I was crazy. But I did have enough confidence that we could get in there and play competitive basketball. We did better than that.
At first, it looked like Bubas' words would come back to haunt him. Duke lost to Wake by 17 and 19. And dropped three games to Carolina by a total of 73 points. They entered the ACC tournament with a mediocre 7-7 conference record. Not surprisingly, outside expectations were low. In the ACC tournament, Duke got hot, knocking off South Carolina, then upsetting Carolina to reach the finals against Wake. The Blue Devils rallied in the second half to defeat the Deacons 63-59. It was Duke's first postseason title in 14 years. Vic Bubas' bold prediction had come true.
It was instant credibility, the realization that we were the champs, that we had come back against Wake Forest, who had a great team, Billy Packer, Chapel. That was just really special time.
We felt that we could win. And that first year was so difficult during the year. And then you reach that goal. Here we are. We're just on the scene now. This just happened. They weren't even my players. I inherited them. But to accomplish that much in our first year, we got a taste of it, and everybody liked it.
But Bubas knew that their initial success would not be sustainable unless changes were made. He knew that for Duke to be on a par with Carolina and State, recruiting would be the key.
Vic Bubas, in my mind, was a classic CEO, corporate guru, mogul, who managed and created a methodology of recruiting that all kinds of people probably follow today. At that time, he was a step ahead of most people.
He was the first great national recruiter. Everybody else had a pipeline to somewhere. Everett Case brought in kids from Indiana. Frank McGuire brought kids in from New York. Bubas would go wherever he had to find talent. I mean, he would go anywhere, everywhere to get a player.
And Bubas didn't waste any time. His first target was New Yorker Art Heyman.
Vic Bubas was named, I think, head coach May 3rd. And he was up the next day at the Hotel Manhattan. And he convinced my parents that I should go to Duke University.
But Heyman had already committed to Frank McGuire at Carolina, where he was to join his high school friend Larry Brown. Heyman's stepfather, however, thought McGuire was only interested in winning games and that his son would not receive the quality education he deserved.
He had committed to North Carolina. This, again, was before national letter of intent. I think he signed a scholarship, but, you know, there was no warranty in there.
Signed my scholarship papers first to University of North Carolina, where I wanted to go with Frank McGuire and Larry Brown, and Dean Smith was the assistant coach.
I said, Art, if you come to Duke, in addition to the great academic challenge that you'll have, and I know a great education, you can be a pioneer at our school. In other words, you can help us get started toward what we hope will be championship ways.
With some coaxing from his family, Heyman agreed to attend Duke. His controversial move to Durham helped launch Bubas and Duke on an incredible run in the 1960s and added fuel to the fire of one of sport's greatest rivalries.
He could embarrass you. I mean, he was so good. He'd take the ball into the lane and, you know, just pump fake and stick it up your nose. I mean, you know, your nose is bleeding and he's at the free throw line shooting. I mean, you know, he wouldn't win many congeniality awards. That's why we loved him as a player.
He represented a level of ability we did not have in the school. He was that good, that strong, and even as a freshman, we saw it. I mean, he was dominating freshman games. And then he comes up as a sophomore with us.
The results were immediate. Duke won 9 straight to start Heyman's first varsity season. But the 10th opponent was Carolina in a non-conference meeting at the Dixie Classic. Despite his best efforts, even Heyman couldn't stop the Tar Heels.
Art told me how Doug Moe had really held him down. I mean, held him scoreless almost for the rest of the game. And it really frustrated him.
On February 4th, 1961, Heyman would get his revenge on Moe, and the rivalry between the two teams went from hot to scalding. They were both undefeated in the ACC. Nationally, Duke was ranked 4th. Carolina was 5th.
When anybody went in for a layup or anybody had an easy basket, Carolina made sure you knew the foul was a real foul. And to me, that was the background when Larry Brown went in for the layup and he got hit.
Larry Brown went for a layup and he blocked it. It was my 5th foul and he just threw the ball and started swinging. And then I swung back and I knocked him out. Donnie Walsh came in and knocked him out. It was a riot.
And I'll never forget, I can picture to this day, Art finally got up. He was so strong and just swinging and flailing and got all the way to half court. Most people would have said, I'm out of there, let's go back. And when he got to half court and realized he'd gotten away, and he turned around and ran back in and tackled about 2 guys, and that's when the crowd kind of erupted, and of course it was quite a Donnybrook.
That was a brawl. And students got on the court. It was nothing to be proud of.
Commissioner at the time stepped in and suspended Heyman and Brown for the rest of the conference season.
Duke won the game and rose to 3rd in the nation. But with Heyman suspended for the remainder of the ACC's regular season, the Blue Devils wavered.
We could have been the national champs that year. We had a great, great team, and that killed us.
In the ACC tournament final, they were overrun by Lynn Chapel and Billy Packer's Demon Deacons. The 1962 season looked promising as sophomore and future All-American Jeff Mullins teamed with Art Heyman to average 46 points a game.
They were really good as teammates, and each of them knew that the other had special abilities. And to have Art Heyman and Jeff Mullins on the floor, they knew that they had the basic tools to have a good team. So they played well together because I think they wanted to win. They knew that's what it would take. I don't think any of them took shots that you and I would call selfish. They understood each other. Out on the court, there was just one purpose.
I respected him, and he respected me, and I wanted him to do so well. It was like the brother I didn't have. He was a great ball player. He reminded me of Jerry West. He could do so many things.
Both of us were hungry players, and both wanted to win, and we had a different set of skills. Art was extremely strong and physical, and I was more of a finesse player, probably a better outside shooter than Art. Vic let us play in a style that really let us excel, and in that we ran the ball up the floor, we scored a lot of points, we really put the pressure on the other team.
But mid-season, Heyman sprained his ankle and never fully recovered. Without their star at his best, Duke was eliminated in the semifinals of the 1962 ACC tournament. In 1963, Heyman was a senior and the team was poised to be the most talented ever. Bubus was looking to add to the deadly duo of Heyman and Mullins with a kid from Missouri with a great work ethic and a deadly shot.
Bill Bradley was one of the tough times that we went through at Duke. On the day that we expected him to get off the plane in the Raleigh-Durham airport, I got a call from his father saying he wasn't going to come to Duke.
Basically, his father had allowed the whole recruiting thing, you know, didn't get involved, basically, and Bill made his choice, and then coming down the stretch, he said his father, who was not a college graduate, was a bank president there in Crystal City, Missouri, and he basically said, Bill, you're going to go to college, you're going to go to Princeton, Harvard, Yale, that's college.
To make matters worse, Bubas passed on big man Fred Hetzel because he had given his last scholarship to Bradley. Hetzel ended up as an All-American for Davidson.
It was a huge disappointment to have a team with somebody like Bill Bradley and Jeff Mullins and Art Heyman would have been a nice trial.
In 1963, Heyman, Mullins, and the rest of the Blue Devils showed no signs they needed Bradley. They were undefeated in the ACC and suffered only two early season losses before rebounding to win 20 in a row. Even rivals Frank McGuire and Everett Case praised Bubas' team, calling it one of the best and most talented of all time. Duke breezed through the ACC tournament by wiping out NC State and Wake. For the second time under Bubas, Duke claimed the ACC trophy.
63 was the first year that we ever made it to the Final Four. And that was a new experience for us. When we got there, we played against Loyola. Everybody comes in ready to go, and they think they're going to be champion. That's what makes it so great.
You didn't have the great scouting report like you have now, because you didn't see them on television, because you didn't have ESPN.
We did not have a good shooting game against Loyola at all. And when you get that far, you can't have an off night.
They started to blow us out early, and we came back with 2 minutes ago. We came back to 3 points, and then they scored the last 12 points. We just got tired out, and I fouled out.
I don't think anybody really understood how good Loyola was either. What it did was introduce us to the Final Four.
With Duke basketball finally in the national spotlight and a team stocked with talent, the innovative Bubas turned his attention to what he felt was another integral part of a championship program.
Vic was big on music. You know, he was the one that started the pep band and really got him dressed up at Duke. I borrowed the University of California's Straw Hat Band, the way they dressed, and asked to put together a band the best they could, and they added a lot of energy to the crowd.
It didn't take long for the students to generate their own energy at the games, giving birth to what would later be called the Cameron Crazies.
When they introduced the players in the varsity, the main game, when I first went to Duke, they would turn off all the lights in the stadium, and then they have a spotlight and say, and for Duke, Jack Maron, and you know, the crowd would just erupt. There's such a roar that you couldn't hear the announcer. Get your adrenaline pumping.
Nothing helps you as much as a team that's very, very good. And all these things put together really did help.
While the loss of Art Heyman to graduation was a blow, Vic Bubas' recruiting prowess prevented any great drop-off.
You know, losing a great player like Art Heyman was a question mark for all of us. But we had a lot of players that had to grow. We were trying to blend in two great young players, Jack Maron and Steve Sindak.
Vasendak and Marin joined Jeff Mullins to help the Blue Devils extend their in-conference winning streak to 26 games. But it was a young team, and their inexperience showed in an early season game against Michigan.
In the Ann Arbor, Jack, Marin, and myself were given our first starting assignments as sophomores. And I think our inexperience showed up in the game, and they took advantage of it. They just beat us that night. But we always felt that if we played again, we could beat them.
The Blue Devils stored their lesson away and cruised to the ACC Finals, where they defeated Wake by 21 points to secure their bid to the NCAA tournament.
That was the year in 1964 that the song Going to Kansas City came out. And Kansas City was where the Final Four was, so that was our theme song.
Going to Kansas City.
Even though Mullins already had a Final Four appearance under his belt, the senior was anxious before Duke's first-round matchup against Villanova.
Vic had a unique way of getting you to relax, and I remember going out of the locker room, and he grabbed me aside, and he said, you take care of this game, I'll get the next one. I think it kind of relaxed me.
Mullins fulfilled his end of the deal. He scored 43 in a first-round game against Villanova, leading his team to an 87-73 win. When they followed that with a 101-54 thumping of UConn, the Blue Devils headed to Kansas City. In the Final Four, Duke showed their developing maturity by defeating a Michigan team that had exposed their inexperience early in the season. Bubas's men were now playing for the national championship.
Greatest moment has to be when you're playing for the national championship. That's it. That's what you dreamt about. That's what you talked about. That's what your kids want. That's the greatest moment.
The impact of being on a nationally ranked basketball team, playing for a national championship, it was so personally stimulating, exciting. You almost have to pinch yourself to make sure it's not a dream.
In the finals, they would play a state school from California, which was also hungry for its first national championship trophy.
UCLA was not really well known. UCLA didn't have much height. The tallest player was 6'5 at the time. They had a great team, but just not a lot known about them on the East Coast.
We met with about every head coach in the Pac-10. They all said to us, don't run up and down with them. I mean, you got these two big guys, you got a nice team, but they are totally dependent on a full court game. But that was us. That was our game. We got to this game running, shooting, pressuring. Who's going to go and tell those guys? Yeah, I know that's how we got here, guys, but we're not going to do that today. And we said, you dance with who brung you. And we played our game.
Coach John Wooden's Bruins, led by Gail Goodrich, Keith Erickson, Walt Hazard, and Jack Hirsch, entered their first championship game 29-0. Still, the Blue Devils led 30-27 until the Bruins turned on their full-court press.
The zone press was something that really disrupted our offense. We were taking jump shots a little further out than we normally would take them, and we were missing jump shots we would normally hit.
They made one of their classic runs about 14 minutes into the first half. I think they ran off like 11 straight, and it got up on us, and that was pretty much the way the ball game went. We could never break back into it.
The Blue Devils were defeated 98-83, and UCLA captured their first national title.
It's just an exceptionally empty feeling. No way to describe it, because we really felt like we could win the national championship.
They may know that they were in the best competition there is, but they're down. And coming back, we had some people meet us out at the airport, and that was nice, and back on the campus. I think the players appreciated that, but deep down, what their dream was.
Bubas recruiting continued to deliver talented players on a consistent basis. And with future All-Americans Bob Verga and Mike Lewis in the lineup, the 1966 team made some noise on the national scene in a pair of games against the two-time national champion, the UCLA Bruins.
We kind of blitzed them right from the get-go. We got on top of them quickly in the first game, and then I think we beat them by 8 or 10, and the second game was actually probably even a little bit easier. So we were riding pretty high after that weekend.
The winning continued, and Bubas' 1966 squad was the class of the ACC. Led by long-range shooter Bob Verga, Duke coasted to the ACC semifinal, where they were matched up against Carolina, a team Duke had easily defeated in the regular season. Tar Heels coach Dean Smith knew his men were no match against the Blue Devils' aggressive offense, so instructed his team to hold the ball. Stalling the game was a new strategy in college basketball. Bubas' team was immediately put on edge by what would later be known as the Four Corners.
The score at halftime, I believe, was like 7-5. But it was just unbelievable because at that time, you could hold the ball and there wasn't any five-second violation.
We didn't extend our defense. We didn't want to spread it out. Coach just said, stand there and look at him, and that's what we did. We stood there and looked at him. It was really a game where people just stood around, and it was not popular.
With 4 seconds left and the game tied at 20, Mike Lewis was fouled inside. He went to the line knowing it was his game to lose.
Of course, I missed the first one. Naturally, I'm saying, oh, this is good. I'm going to choke. A million things go through your mind. Everybody after the fact says, oh, I was just, you know, guys lie and say, well, you know, it's just like in practice. Like hell it was like in practice. It wasn't like in practice, but I was fortunate enough to make the second shot, and we win the game and move on to the championship game.
After disposing of the Tar Heels, Bubas' men captured their third ACC title in 4 years and returned to the NCAA tournament. With victories over St. Joseph's and Syracuse, Duke looked forward to another Final Four appearance, this time against number one Kentucky. But as the big game drew near, Bubas' biggest concern was not on the Wildcats, but on the health of a star player who had fallen extremely ill.
I woke up about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, and I was like on fire. I had a terrible temperature. I think I had like 103 or 104 fever. They didn't let me out of the hospital until Thursday of that week when we flew up to College Park for the finals, the NCAA finals.
Bubas took a gamble and played his ailing star. Verga, who averaged 20 points a game during the season, managed only 2 baskets all night. And without their strongest lineup, Duke lost to Kentucky, 83-79.
Would we have beaten Kentucky with a well Bob Verga? Maybe. You never know. But that might have been the difference with us being able to beat Kentucky or not, which would then put us in the championship game against Texas Western.
Obviously, you can't feel responsibility for being sick in terms of letting your teammates down, but you certainly are tremendously disappointed that one of the biggest moments of your life has to be derailed because you came down with a strep throat. I obviously had to reflect on the fact that I was probably the principal reason that we weren't moving on.
Bob Verga's senior year average of 26.1 points per game remains a record even to this day.
I shudder to think what he would have scored if there had been a three-point shot. I bet half of the shots he took in a game were beyond the three-point line.
Verga's graduation marked the end of Duke's supremacy on Tobacco Road. Over the next 3 seasons, Bubas' men failed to capture the ACC title. Losses to Carolina in 67 and 69 and NC State in 68 signaled a shift in power in the ACC. After the 1969 season, Vic Bubas stepped down as head coach. With 213 wins and only 67 losses, he was one of the most successful coaches in the 1960s. Under his leadership, the Blue Devils were ranked in the top 10 for 6 seasons while making 3 Final Four appearances.
Vic came in and was the one who lifted us before the game and during the games. He was the guy who you got your energy from and your confidence in what you were about to do. We played with great confidence all the years I was at Duke.
His legacy is not only the quality of the people, the quality of the basketball players as far as their talents, but the way the program was conducted and how it so complemented a great university.
Choosing Duke's 16th head coach was easy. Bucky Waters had spent 7 years at Duke as Bubas' assistant in the early 60s before moving to the University of West Virginia's head coach. He knew the workings of Duke basketball better than anyone. Perhaps the most memorable night of Waters' tenure was the January 22, 1972 matchup against number 3 Carolina. It was the night Duke Indoor was renamed in honor of former coach and longtime athletic director Eddie Cameron. Robbie West's winning basket with 3 seconds left christened the court, and the Blue Devils upset their rival 76-74. But the excitement would not last. Waters' tough-as-nails approach was not a good fit at an American university amid the social upheaval of the late 60s and early 70s.
I should have been more flexible, I think, in that era, because the kids were different. I probably wasn't as tolerant of some of the attitudes and experiences that they were dealing with off the court.
There were athletes, perhaps all sports, but we hear the story in relation to basketball, that just rebelled over short hair, over bed checks or times, over stringent regulations that were commonplace prior to then.
In Waters' fourth season, Duke was 12-14, 4-8 in the ACC. Not surprisingly, Bucky Waters' enjoyment for the game was gone, and in 1973, he resigned.
I really loved Duke and Duke basketball, but the circumstances at the time took all the fun out of it, and a lot of it wasn't Duke's fault. It was just hard. Guys like Dean Smith let their hair grow and wore loud sport coats, and they coped well. They got through it, and I did not.
I think if he would have stayed on at Duke in another era, tried the same thing in another time, probably would have worked.
To start the 1974 season, Duke hired assistant coach Neil McGahee. But after the Blue Devils finished a school worst 2-10 in the ACC, the school began to search for a coach who could restore the program to its winning ways. In 1975, that search ended when Duke hired Utah's Bill Foster.
Carl James wanted to get someone to build the program, and that's what he looked for, was a builder, and he found Bill Foster. And Bill had been a great builder of programs. He had built the Rutgers program back. He went to Utah and had the running Utes and took them to the NIT and just really did a great job.
He was like a one-player-at-a-time recruiter. His first big get was Jim Spanarkle from New Jersey, who was regarded as a good but not great prospect. Turned out to be a very good college player.
Duke was going through like a downtime in basketball after the years of like Art Haman and Jeff Mullen. There was a blank time, if you will, where they kind of tailed off a little bit. So I honestly had not heard a whole lot about them.
For the 1977 season, Foster added center Mike Jaminski in one of the great recruiting coups.
Jaminski was a high school junior in Connecticut. Bill Foster found out before anybody else that Mike Jaminski was going to graduate at the end of his junior year. Well, Jaminski and Spanarkle became the foundation for what Bill built.
It really was a good fit. And it was just a confidence in Coach Foster and his ability to build programs. And I saw something there that I thought could be special, and I wanted to be a part of that rebuilding process.
After losing the 1977 season opener to Wake, traces of the old Blue Devils emerged. Led by Spanarkle and the ACC scoring leader Tate Armstrong, Foster's team won 10 in a row. They even broke a 28-game, 5-year ACC road losing streak when they beat Virginia 82-74 in overtime. But the celebration was short-lived.
We had just cracked the top 20 for the first time in, you know, Lord knows how long. And then we went up to Virginia, and Tate broke his wrist early in the game. He was out for the rest of the year, and we were never the same. We couldn't overcome not having him.
With their star out, Foster's team finished dead last in the ACC for the second straight year.
We lost a lot of close games over a period of time, so it wasn't like we were getting blown out by the quality of competition in the ACC. I mean, we're knocking on the door, we're just coming up a little bit short, and that, you know, if we get the right players, then it meshes, that we were going to be able to make some noise.
If the recruitment of Jaminski was a coup, Foster's next addition was a coronation.
It's hard to recapture what Gene Banks meant as a prospect. Gene Banks was the number one prospect in the country.
I remember it was like a rock star coming down when he visited campus, and just the fact that Duke was involved with this guy at all.
They're starting to throw the ball behind their back, and everything else. They're feeling great, see?
Bill Foster was the coach at the time, and he stopped by the school and gave a book of the campus, not of the team, but of the campus of Duke. And my high school coach gave it to me, and I was walking, I was giving it tutored by Dr. William H. Detweiler, who was my English teacher. He looked at the book, he says, Duke, fine institution, great academics. He says, why don't you go visit? And I said, okay.
But with top programs like UCLA, Michigan, and Notre Dame all vying for his signature, Banks was torn.
I was real confused because I liked the decision of going to Duke, but when I asked my mother to give me some help, and she just said to me, listen, she says, just pray on it. I laid down, and all I dreamt about was Duke, how we were going to go to the championship game, how I was walking around campus. And the very next day, I called my high school coach and the principal, and I said, we need to make a press conference.
The day Gene Banks committed to Duke, they sold out season tickets for the next year.
And in addition to his powerful starting lineup, Foster's Blue Devils were deep. Players like Kenny Dennard, Scott Gatch, and Harold Morrison were an integral part to the team. Transfers Bob Bender, who was a bench player for Indiana's 1976 championship team, and John Harrell from nearby North Carolina Central were also valuable additions to the lineup.
It was a very unique situation, and you could tell when they played that they enjoyed playing with each other, and they helped each other out during a game.
We came together and we trusted each other, on and off the field. There was a lot of trust. We would go to hell and back for each other during that time, and even after.
About 10, 12, 13 games left in the regular season, we didn't know it, but we started to get hot, and we started to win, and then we win games 16, 17, 18, we start winning. We didn't know that we were gonna win 8 or 9 more, and we were gonna get on this roll where we probably won, you know, 14 out of our last 16 games.
The game that I felt like we arrived is the home game in Cameron against North Carolina. And we beat them pretty soundly that day. North Carolina had beaten Duke so often and so soundly in the early 70s that there was finally, I think, a sense of, hey, we can compete now with this program. It was really special to go over to the ACC tournament that year because, you know, for so many years before, Coach Foster used to joke around that the only thing he used to pack is a handkerchief. So after the first game, he could cry and then go back to Durham. But there was a sense that we were packing for the weekend.
In the 1978 ACC tournament, Foster's underestimated team dominated and upset Wake 85-77 to capture the school's first ACC title since 1966.
The buzzer goes off. The first thing I'm thinking, we're going to the NCAA tournament. I'm jumping around, Mike's jumping around, Coach Foster's jumping around, a lot of hugging.
To go from the pits in the ACC at the bottom level to winning the ACC tournament, no one would have guessed that.
They were a lovable bunch, and everybody could identify with them because there were kids on that team from almost every walk of life. And I think anybody who loved basketball anywhere in the country could look at that team and pick out a couple of guys that they could really identify with.
The Blue Devils continued to impress in the NCAA tournament, advancing to the semifinal where they defeated Diggerfeld Fighting Irish to set up a meeting with a highly favored Kentucky team in the finals.
They were the anti-Duke, senior laden. They've been through it before, and we came into it, we're just happy to be there.
Kentucky people called it the year without fun. They had to win the championship or that would have been a disaster.
I remember it was hot. It was as hot a gym as I'd ever been in, walking out in that second game. And so I think the heat and the enormity of that thing really kind of overwhelmed me.
We knew they had Cal Macy and we had Phillips and Roby. The thing was, we felt our matchup zone, our 2-3 zone was strong. We stopped everybody with it, pretty much. The only thing we just had a problem was that Goose Givens had an answer for that 2-3 zone.
Givens is a 17-point scorer, and he scores 41. Mostly contested shots. Banks one in from the corner. You know, has some, when you're having nights like that, those things go for you. All that said, you know, they win by six. And if he has his normal game, you know, we win going away.
Duke lost the championship 94-88.
Looking back, yeah, it was nice that we had this innocence about us, and I just don't know if we were ready to win. We were so young, and the crowd was, our crowd was with us, and I think all of us had a sense that, okay, if we win, great. If we don't, we'll be back next year.
We walked out from the locker room, onto the court, hand in hand, every guy from the first guy to the 12th guy. And everybody saw it, the Duke fans saw it, the Kentucky fans saw it, everybody saw it. And we just, like a chain, we held each other's hand, we came on out. And the Duke fans cheered us on and said, we'll be back, we'll be back.
And they showed their support for us, you know, by saying, all right, so you lost, big deal. You know, we're gonna walk out of here collectively with our heads in the air.
It really chokes you up. I mean, it really does. And I just think about it today. It's a wonderful moment. When I look back at that game with Kentucky, we really had a heck of a team, period. We've had a lot of success and won a lot of games. We just didn't win them all. And that's what you're supposed to do.
In Foster's final year as coach, the team was able to capture the conference title again. But after the 1980 season, Bill Foster left to take the coaching job at South Carolina. Athletic director Tom Butters made an unexpected choice to replace Foster.
I got a call that the afternoon of the press conference saying, you're not going to believe who they just hired. It was from a friend in the administration. I said, no, who? And he says, well, I can't tell you because I can't pronounce his name, but it's the guy at Army.
That guy was Army's 32-year-old head coach, Mike Krzyzewski.
I called a friend of mine who coached in the ECAC and had coached against Krzyzewski. And I said, tell me about this guy. And he said, well, he's a brilliant coach. He's going to change the way they play defense in the ACC. They're going to play tough, hard-nosed. He says, my only question, I don't know if he can recruit at the level he'll have to recruit at.
A lot of people said, well, yeah, I don't think you could win at Duke. I looked at it as like going to heaven. I mean, you talk about restrictions, try to recruit for one of the military academies, you know. And I looked at Duke as being, I said, are you kidding me? You know, this will be great. My first full year of recruiting, we got beat. We went after a number of kids. We didn't get any of them. You know, we lost out. And we evaluated ourselves. And we said, you know, we're recruiting too many kids. As a result of that, the following year, we had the top recruiting class in the country.
That recruiting class included David Henderson, Jay Billis, Mark Allery, and Johnny Dawkins. But as freshmen in 1983, they were far from the powerhouse team they would become.
It was a tough year. You know, we were 11-17. I think we ended that year with a 43-point loss to Virginia in the ACC tournament.
Those first 3 years, we were 38-47. You know, we got our butts beat a lot. I had people here who wanted me to go. We have the Iron Dukes, our fundraising element, Scott for scholarships and that. There was a thing called the Concerned Iron Dukes. They were concerned about me being their coach.
Despite his troublesome record, athletic director Tom Butters extended Krzyzewski's contract.
You know, when you're at a school like Duke, people understand a big picture more. You know, they can look at something and say, look, you know, we didn't win 25 games this year. We won 18. You know, our kids played hard. They graduated. Be proud of that. That's the way my administration was. I asked them, I said, you know, everything okay? He says, you just do things the way Duke would want them to be done, and you'll be fine. I never worried one day about losing my job.
By the time his star recruits were seniors in 1986, Krzyzewski had built a college basketball juggernaut.
Dawkins, Allery, Billis, Henderson. Are you kidding me?
Well, I think of the guys on that team, I think of a lot of good friends. When you're on the floor with them, you always felt we got a chance to beat anybody we come up against.
With the help of junior Tommy Amaker and freshman Danny Ferry, Duke brought home the ACC trophy for the first time in 6 years and made its second appearance in the NCAA championship game in over two decades.
The Duke had to play Kansas again in the semifinals and beat them. It was also the 39th game of Duke's season. So when game number 40 rolled around, they just didn't quite have the legs to beat a Louisville team that they were better than.
Even with the loss, Duke finished the season with 37 wins, an unprecedented number at that time. The concerned Iron Dukes were no longer worried.
We had the character that we needed to build our program on. That's why that class, the class of 86, to me, is really the class that gave us the foundation, not just talent-wise, but the way the kids should be for my program.
Through it all, there was one star who shined the brightest, National Player of the Year Johnny Dawkins. As a senior in 1986, he led his team in scoring for the fourth consecutive year and ended his career with over 2,500 points, making him Duke's all-time leading scorer, a record he holds even today.
And they've intercepted it. Bricky's got the ball. That's it.
Then 88, they're back in the Final Four. 88, 89, and, you know, they're just, they're reloading.
Krzyzewski reloaded with a kid from Maryland who was a bright-eyed, eager freshman on the 86 team named Danny Ferry.
Even as a freshman, had an impact in what we were doing because of his great talent, and also he had a terrific work ethic as well.
Ferry enabled Duke to continue growing after 86 and launched the Blue Devils on the most incredible run in college basketball. In Ferry's 4 years, he played in three Final Fours and won two ACC championships, and as a senior in 1989, was the National Player of the Year. Despite the loss of Ferry to graduation, the Blue Devils were back in the national championship game in 1990. Led by Phil Henderson, Christian Laettner, and freshman Bobby Hurley, the Blue Devils faced an extremely athletic UNLV team.
They were very intimidating. Larry Johnson was a fierce competitor, really a solid player inside out. And you know, they just had the athletes on the wings that could run the court.
As the old saying goes, UNLV took them to the woodshed and didn't spare the rod at all. I mean, they just flat put it to Duke and beat them by 30 points and embarrassed them.
My mom walks in and she looks at me, and she's just a great, great lady, the greatest person in my life. And she says, Mike. I said, Ma, you know, says, Mike, you know, don't worry. You know, next year you'll do better. So I looked at her and I said, Ma, we just played in a national championship game. You know, how are we going to do better?
Having been to the Final Four in four of the last 5 years, no longer would better than most be acceptable. So when the talented 91 squad faltered early in the season at Virginia, Krzyzewski decided a wake-up call was in order.
Duke started that year supposed to be good, but not great. There was an early season game at Virginia that they lost, and they lost badly, and Kay brought them back.
We arrived at Cameron from the bus trip, and he basically got up on the bus and said, you know, I need you guys taped and ready for practice in 15 minutes. So I think it all kind of happened so fast, you didn't have time to really think.
I mean, guys were kind of shocked. I mean, we couldn't believe the coach done it, but everyone did it. Everyone got taped and went out there, and he really got after us.
I went up for a layup or something, and my roommate came, and Tony Lang, and went for the foul, and ended up breaking my nose in practice. So it was definitely a long day.
The impromptu practice jump-started the team, and Duke dropped only three more regular season games. They finished the regular season with 25 wins and 6 losses and found their way to the national semifinal, where they faced the defending champs, a new, improved, and undefeated UNLV.
They were good the year before and they beat us by 30, but they were even better the next year when I was a junior.
They not only were undefeated, they were unthreatened. They had not trailed, as I believe this is true, they had not trailed a minute in the second half of any game they played that year. Nobody had come close to them, and Duke was given almost no chance.
Unlike the year before, we had a week to prepare.
And I remember we used to practice, you know, 7 against 5 or 6 guys against 5, where UNLV would have 6 or 7 guys against our, you know, against our 5. And he was doing that because sometimes they were so good, it seemed like they had 6 guys out there.
He convinced them they could win the game. And he convinced them that they didn't have a player to match up with Christian Lathan, which is true.
He also thought UNLV had a chink in its armor.
Be interesting to see how UNLV reacted if they were put in a do-or-die situation. Well, folks, with the eyes of the entire nation upon this ball game tonight, they have game pressure of the biggest kind they've faced all year long. Hurley for 3, bottom!
How many big ones does he hit? Add it to the list.
He would say to us, if we get him in a tight game the last 2 minutes, we're going to be the ones with the advantage because they haven't been in a tight game all year.
Krzyzewski's instincts were right, and after an even second half, Duke squeaked past Las Vegas 79-77.
Now to Johnson, make him bring it up with 9 seconds left. Johnson to the right side. Johnson fakes, looking, 5 seconds to Hunt. Anderson Hunt stops, fires a 3. No! It's off the mark! It's over!
Grant came over and grabbed me and was like, all right, this is over now. You could stop dribbling. There's a disbelief about, you know, beating them. They were that good.
It was just, you know, stunner. Duke beats Vegas. It was, nobody could believe it.
For the third time in 6 years, Krzyzewski's team would have the opportunity to win Duke basketball's first national title. Kansas was the only thing standing in their way.
Duke against Kansas with all the marbles laying on the court here at the Hoosier Dome.
I think we were a better team than them, but they were so well coached that, you know, you had to really be on guard with them. We were too good at that point. Grant Hill made a big difference on our team.
The lob to Grant Hill, oh! And it's stopped for Grant. What a play.
That ball was well to the right of the backboard. Grant Hill somehow leapt up, caught it with one hand, and slammed it home with authority.
But we just made good decisions, managed the clock well, secured a nice lead. Billy McCaffrey in that game for us came through and made some big shots.
To the corner, McCaffrey for 3, bottom! With 5 seconds, 4 seconds, 3, 2, Jordan, let's fly! It is over! The Destiny Darlings have done it! The Duke Blue Devils have won their first ever national basketball championship!
I mean, it's just the epitome of, man, I'm here at Duke and we won a national championship and this is what I wanted more than anything in the whole world. And you're hugging everybody that you went to war with.
It was a great feeling of excitement and joy, naturally. And we did it. You know, a feeling of excitement and fun and wanting to party and just enjoy the moment.
The campus kind of let out a huge roar because it was something that they really wanted.
With the addition of Cherokee Parks to a team that returned 4 starters from the championship squad, the 1992 team had only one goal, winning another national title.
My 92 team was the most talented team I've ever coached.
You won a national championship and you're only a junior and you know you're coming back with the same team and you know you're playing for the best coach and there's a good chance you're gonna be there again your senior year, so You know, we were all feeling good about ourselves.
They started the year preseason number one. There were expectations to win again, except for the little caveat that nobody repeated. If Vegas couldn't do it, could Duke?
They were lights out in January. We're beating everybody by 20 points.
Duke would lose just twice in the season. As the year progressed, the atmosphere was more like a carnival than a basketball game.
We went to games, and there'd be hundreds of people after a ball game, you know, picture taking. A couple times we took Hurley out of the gym in an equipment bag.
They put me in one of the towel bags because I could fit in there, and they just carried me out and put me on the bus. Well, it kind of hurt my hip when they threw me down in the aisle and I landed on my hip, you know, just got done playing 35 minutes and like a sack of potatoes, they threw me on the bus.
When Leitner went out on the court, I mean, especially with the female population, I mean, it was, you know, pictures being taken all the time.
I guess, you know, I guess they were in the Christian Leitner's good looks or whatever, because there were a lot of Leitner lovers out there who just would go goo-goo over seeing him.
It was a circus, and we kind of had the rock star status where everywhere we went, there was, you know, young girls screaming, 10-year-old girls screaming, so it was a lot of fun, and we enjoyed it, we loved it, and we would, you know, joke about it as much as we can.
Duke finished the season with another ACC title and held on to the number one ranking as they entered the national tournament. In the Sweet 16, Bobby Hurley helped defeat his brother Danny's Seton Hall team, and the Blue Devils advanced to the regional final against Kentucky.
They were run and gun, precious, shoot three-pointers, score 100 points, 110 points. And those teams can beat you. Even at Duke, where you play really good D, those teams can beat you.
Dale Brown.
There was so much drama surrounding the Duke-Kentucky game, and it was just like one great play after another, and people stepping up and making big shots, and every shot bigger than the next until, you know, there's no one left standing.
In overtime, with 3 seconds left, Kentucky's Sean Woods took a straight-on bank shot, putting Kentucky up by one and demoralizing the Blue Devils.
Timeout Duke with 2.1 seconds left, and Duke takes his last timeout.
Coach K did a great job at making us feel good about ourselves, even though we were down one. He said, okay, we can win this game. You know, while we're sitting in the timeout, he's stressing to us that we have a chance to win this game. Get your heads up. He drew up a nice play for us, a play that we had practiced. It's called home run. It's another end of game situation.
He's like, Grant, can you make this pass from out of bounds to Christian at the top of the key? And like Grant says, yeah, I could throw that pass.
Grant threw a great pass. I was able to make the catch. And after that, it's just, you know, get a good look, and I was able to get a good look.
Leitner, they throw at the left of the floor. Leitner catches, comes down, dribbles, shoots, scores! Christian Leitner has hit the bucket at the buzzer! The Blue Devils win it, 104-103! Look out, Minneapolis! Here come the Blue Devils!
The second it left his hand, it had great rotation, and it seemed like it was in the air forever, but it looked good the whole time, and I was just like anticipating it going in, and it just did.
After dispatching Indiana in the semifinal, the Blue Devils found themselves one game away from repeating as national champs. But to do so, they would have to beat Michigan's Fab Five.
To have them all be freshmen and to have that swagger, it was kind of unsettling, you know? Like, do they believe their own hype, and are they really that good? And then you played against them and you realize that they are really that good.
But on the verge of history, Duke faltered. Leitner, perhaps still recovering from his dramatic performance against Kentucky, scored only 5 first-half points while turning the ball over 7 times.
Jump pass back outside, stolen by Jalen Rose. Rose against Brian Davis. Goes around, he puts it up and in.
The Blue Devils went into the locker room trailing Michigan's Fab 5.
I do remember Bobby, you know, yelling at us a little bit. He didn't stand up and yell at us very often, but he did that day. I was glad to see it.
I just think he was getting a little worn down, and it took so much out of him. And it just took someone to really shake him up and challenge him a little bit. And that's mainly what I was trying to do. I was challenging him to reach deep down and give to us what we needed, what he had given to us, you know, his whole career.
Hurley's halftime challenge sparked Leitner into action. He scored 14 in the second half, and Duke held Michigan to just 20 second-half points.
We were able to come out and set the tone right away in the beginning of the second half, and Christian made a few big plays, and he kind of got out of a funk that he was in.
Three-point perimeter, looks for Leitner to pop outside. He does, turns for the three, bottoms! Christian Leitner's second three has put the Blue Devils up now by 7 points.
And then Grant was phenomenal in that second half. He was, you know, dunking on the baseline, just making all kinds of plays for us. And, you know, we just kind of took over.
Duke overwhelmed the Fab Five 71-51.
They said it couldn't be done, but Duke has done it again. Mike Krzyzewski's Blue Devils started the season number one. They finished number one. And now, for the second year in a row, they wear the crown of the king.
There was nothing left to prove. Mike Krzyzewski had molded Duke into the premier college basketball program. Amazingly, his teams had appeared in 6 Final Fours in 7 years and became the first team in 19 years to win back-to-back national championships.
The game of college basketball had not had any team repeat as champions since UCLA, and other teams were close and have been close since. But we were the ones who were fortunate enough to do it.
It sank in for me right away. Right away, I was realizing that we had accomplished something great. And I kept saying to myself, that's why I chose to go to Duke.
It separated us from all the other teams that had won. I mean, now we're back-to-back champs, an unbelievable accomplishment. We realized that we'll go down as, you know, one of the greatest teams in the history of college basketball. And, of course, Coach K will go down as one of the greatest coaches.
The 1992 championship title game was also Christian Leitner's last as a Blue Devil. Duke's second all-time leading scorer was a 3-time All-American, the 1991 tournament MVP, and made an unprecedented 4 Final Four appearances. In 1993, Duke said goodbye to another of its greats. When Bobby Hurley took off his Blue Devil jersey for the last time after the loss to Cal in the second round of the NCAA tournament, the All-American left the game as the NCAA's all-time assist leader, a record he still holds.
There isn't any kid that I personally identified with more than Bobby Hurley. Bobby was the player I wanted to be.
Bobby and Thomas have been like sons to me. They've taken me to places and have experiences that no other college coach has had over the last 20 years.
And I just couldn't get over that, even at the press conference afterwards. It was just, it was this emotional, and it wasn't about the loss. It was that.
Every time that we went out on a court, I knew that they would give me their bodies, their minds, and their hearts. I'm only sad that I can't do it anymore with him.
As it had been after the departure of Dawkins, Ferry, and others, Duke remained one of the premier teams. Behind Grant Hill and Antonio Lang, Duke went to the national championship game for the 5th time in 9 years when they faced off against Arkansas in 1994.
Cable gets out on him. He finds McDaniel out further away from the offensive end. Back to back on the left. He takes Cable baseline, feeds it out front. Stewart drops the ball, gets it back. 2 seconds, 1 second. He lets fly with a shot.
Oh,
he counted. counted as the shot clock ran down the three-pointer. It is 73-70 with 46 seconds left.
Scotty Thurman puts up a shot just as the shot clock buzzes and goes. And I swear to you, Tony Lang's fingers touch it. The shot goes in for the three. Duke can't answer. Arkansas beats Duke and robs K of his third title.
Despite the loss, Krzyzewski's place in history is set. In just over 10 years, he has gone from some guy at Army to a household name who set the standard by which every college program would be judged. Three ACC titles, seven Final Four appearances, and two national championships. But in 1995, it all came crashing down.
When I was recruiting in September, I was on the run. It was an unbelievable pain. It was coming all down my leg. And so I started the season, and after a week, I mean, I was having real trouble. I was tested by a neurosurgeon, and he had me do this test where you hop on one foot and hop on another. When I hopped on this one, I collapsed. And my foot went, at that time, went dead. It was a ruptured disc that was pinching a nerve.
His doctors are telling him, you got to rest, you got to give it time to heal. And Kay's thinking, well, it's just pain, I can deal with that.
The doctor said, we need to operate on you right away and we can fix the problem. I was so powerful in my persuasive abilities, I persuaded everybody to allow me to come back full tilt after a week. It was stupid.
He was pale, he was gray, he looked weak. And here was this guy who was the pillar of strength all the time. Now, you know, he's standing there telling us that he didn't know how long he was going to be out. I mean, you could have heard a pin drop in that room. Guys were kind of looking around like, what's going on here? This is Coach K. He's not a human. You know, he's a machine.
The pain proved too much. After coaching 12 games, he took a leave of absence and handed the reins over to his assistant coach, Pete Gaudette.
We lost about 9-10 games in a row, and all the games came down to the wire. It was almost like we had it there for the taking, but without our leader, you know, when it was time to band together and to get a win, we just crumbled.
Without Krzyzewski, the Blue Devils lost 15 of their last 19 games, and for the first time in 12 years, failed to make the NCAA tournament.
I'm still responsible for this program. And some of the problems that they had were not a result of those kids or those assistant coaches taking over. It was me not training properly for them to take over.
Unwilling to leave the team in disarray, Krzyzewski returned for the 1996 season. In many ways, the program was back at square one. So Krzyzewski returned to his strength, recruiting.
The class of freshmen in 1998 was his first real number one class. So Shane Battier won one of the National Player of the Year awards. Most recruiting analysts had Chris Burgess ranked number one in the class. Elton Brand was right in the top five. And Will Avery was a McDonald's All-American. And they were the foundation for the success in 98-99.
That class, they were multi-dimensional players. We developed depth in our ability to put good lineups out there all the time.
My career went full circle. It was my freshman year. We hit 13-18 rock bottom to where my senior year, Duke was back to its normal place in college basketball.
In 1999, the team went to a place where no one had gone before. Corey Maggette joined Brand, Avery, and Trajan Langdon on a team that dominated the ACC and set the ACC record for average margin of victory with a 24.7 point spread. Krzyzewski also earned his fourth ACC title with a 23-point thrashing of Carolina.
We knew that we had a chance to really bring Duke back up to the level that it had been in the early 90s.
They were 16-0 in the ACC, 19-0 counting the tournament, and almost none of the games were close. They just overpowered the league.
Everyone made a big to-do about this team because we had talent. We beat teams with really good defense, but I thought we were one of the two or three best teams in the country, and we proved that, but we didn't win the whole thing.
Led by senior Trajan Langdon, the Blue Devils nearly gave Krzyzewski his third title, but fell to UConn 77-74. Shortly after, in 2000, Krzyzewski was faced with a new challenge when William Avery, Elton Brand, and Corey Maggette all announced they would be leaving school early to enter the NBA draft. It was a trend that had become commonplace in college basketball, but had yet to penetrate Duke.
At the time, it was almost like Chicken Little proclaiming the sky is falling, and everyone on the campus was almost in shock.
Well, luckily, Kay has his second number one recruiting class. Jason Williams, Mike Dunleavy, Carlos Boozer, Casey Sanders.
You know, a few months before I reported to school, there was a lot of guys left school, and the door kind of opened for some of the younger players, as well as the older guys, to have bigger roles and play a bigger part.
Perhaps none of the newcomers played a bigger part than Jason Williams.
He's as electrifying a player as I've ever seen on the college level. If you look at the things he did, the moments he had, he was an amazing talent, and he was a great personality.
Williams would ultimately share National Player of the Year honors with Shane Battier in 2001 and win it outright in 2002. But he may best be remembered for his 2001 performance in the regular season against Maryland in what was dubbed the Miracle Minute. With the visiting Blue Devils trailing by 10 with a minute left, Jason Williams took control of the situation. He scored the next 8 points to lead Duke into overtime, where Williams and his teammates came out with an extraordinary 98-86 victory.
He had 10 turnovers in that game. So, I mean, he would do things and he would go from the lowest to low and then all of a sudden score 16 points in a row, and you're like, wow, this guy's amazing.
Duke cruised through the NCAA tournament and drew Maryland in the semifinal. The Terps wasted little time in avenging the Miracle Minute.
We were getting absolutely trounced in the first half. We were down 20, and we couldn't do anything right. We were unconfident. We were scared. We were tentative. We were not ourselves.
We were in there with a freshman point guard, a sophomore, and Jason Williams, Dunleavy, Boozer, and Shane was a senior, certainly, but it's a really young team. The environment of the Final Four, our guys were nervous. They weren't reacting. And, you know, when they came to that huddle at the 12-minute mark, Coach was like, look, just relax and play.
And the funny thing happened, we hit a few shots. You see our confidence started to rise. And the same thing happened in College Park as it did in Minneapolis. You see the confidence and the spirit just drain from their eye. They didn't really truly believe that they could put us away. And that's all we needed to see. We actually ended up winning the game by 10 and set up the national title game.
For the second time in 3 years, Krzyzewski was leading his team in a national championship game. This time, they would face Arizona.
99, I was just a role player, and it was more Trey and Langan's team. So I felt personally responsible to try to get us over the hump this time.
Second half, Mike Dunleavy goes off making threes.
Dunleavy three, bottoms again! Mike Dunleavy heating it up.
Our roommate got hot from three. And he had three threes in about a 2 minute stretch.
But he didn't win the game. Shane Battier won the game.
Shane Battier with a gutsy play.
Shane Battier made about four or five of the most remarkable plays down the stretch. He made a backwards tip-in that was just amazing. Battier carried Duke.
No, I'll just never forget the feeling of looking up at the clock, and when they stopped following with about 20 seconds to go, I said, oh my gosh, we did it.
Battier led his team to an 82-72 victory. For the third time in 10 years, the Blue Devils were national champions.
Following Jason and Shane's lead, you know, we were able to win a national championship.
Well, the first person I looked for was my roommate, Mike Dunleavy. And then Jason Williams jumped on us, and all of a sudden the whole team just mobbed us.
You know, the kid that I went to hug, tried to hug the first, was Shane. He's crying, and I just whispering in his ear, son, thanks for the ride. You know, we won this because of you.
For Krzyzewski, the win solidified his place as one of the greats in college basketball. he was only the fourth coach to win three national championships.
Third title, it really sets him apart. And I think for him, after going through the injuries he did in 95, where a lot of people counted him out and never thought that Duke would get back to where they should be, and that's at the top. For him to come in 01 and win the third, separate him from a whole bunch of coaches that have won two.
A month later, Krzyzewski became the first person from Duke elected into the Basketball Hall of Fame. At a time when most would be resting on their laurels, Krzyzewski continues to accumulate them. He led Duke to six of the last seven ACC titles. His 10th Final Four appearance in 2004 meant that from 1986 through 2007, only one class failed to make a Final Four under his leadership. And in December 2004, Krzyzewski won his 700th career game.
To coach at Duke has been like a dream. I'm the luckiest guy in the world because I'm doing what I love to do at the best place that you can do it.
Firmly established as one of the greats in college basketball, Krzyzewski continues to lead Duke's program to greatness. It is a program that in its 100th year is everything Washington Duke, Cap Card, and Eddie Cameron had envisioned. A program that matches the university's academic aspiration to achieve at the highest level and to sustain that achievement with dignity. A look back at Duke's first 100 years reveals a persistent pursuit of excellence, an unflinching fortitude in the face of challenge, and a program that is and will always be second to none.